Good morning and welcome to worship. For those who don't know me, my name's Heather Allison, and I'm for one more week a hospital chaplain in the public system. But I'm happy to be here today in Louise's absence, and so let us all gather for worship. Nicole, I wonder if you could. Today we celebrate the 47th anniversary of the United Church, which was actually yesterday, but we're celebrating that today. So let's join in this call to worship. Praise to God for the gifts of the past,
for the witness of all the people of God who went before us.
Praise to God for the gifts of the present,
and all our struggles to be true to Christ.
Praise to God for the gifts in our future.
The Spirit will nail them on into crucifixions and resurrections.
God of grace, as we celebrate today the formation of the United Church in Australia, we ask you to be present with us and remind us of who we are as a church and what we are called to do and be in your name.
Open our hearts and minds to your vision for the church.
Let us worship God. Amen. Amen. We're going to begin with Praise with Joy, the World's Creator.
Oh,
We're going to start now with a prayer of remembering. And this is to celebrate the anniversary of the Uniting Church. As we begin this service of worship, acknowledging the 47th anniversary of church union, we remember our heritage and the gifts of the churches that came together. We celebrate the commitment in the congregational tradition to freedom, to the power of the priesthood of all believers, and a church that ordained women in the 1920s. We celebrate the commitment in the Methodist tradition to social justice and an enthusiasm in communicating the gospel. We celebrate the commitment in the Presbyterian tradition to scholarship and a deep understanding of the nature of the church. We stand in awe of these great traditions. We celebrate the covenant made between the Uniting Church and the Uniting Aboriginal and Islander Christian Congress in 1994. We honour the first people of this land and pay respects to their leaders who work towards reconciliation. But know this, in Christ we are one. In Christ everything is made new. Thanks be to God. Amen. Now we're going to pray our prayer of confession, but I'm going to invite you again to be part of that. So the bold print, please. Let us join in our prayers of confession. On the Day of Union, we committed the Uniting Church to be one people in the Spirit of Christ.
We are still divided.
We committed to be a pilgrim people.
But often we have refused to move and change.
We committed to use the gifts of all the people of for the kingdom.
But we refuse to call forth the gifts and offer them to you.
We committed to be servants to the world.
But we have turned away into our own service and closed our eyes to the pain of others.
Forgive us, O God, and help us to renew our commitment to live out the hope to which we are called. Amen. Folks, in Christ, our hope is new every day, and there is no condemnation. So rise up and live as free and forgiven people of God. Thanks be to God. All right, now we're going to sing a hymn. It says there, 392, that's the tune, but the words are going to be up there. This is a hymn that was written, and it was kind of adopted at, I think it might have been the 40th anniversary of the Uniting Church, so some years ago, but it's got lovely words. So let's, so in the church, that's moving forward.
Church that's moving forward. This is where we belong to be. In a church with gifts abounding and the grace to set men
Do possible for the next year.
Now, Craig, I believe you're going to do some announcements.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
First of all, I just want to say a big thank you to Reverend Heather for filling in for Louisa this morning. It's a privilege to have you here, Heather. Thank you. Thank you for coming and joining us. So the third announcement there, obviously, is Louisa is away for the next few weeks on her army training down in Canungra. So next week we're going to have Dr. Dennis Shanks come and visit us. So it's great we get all these guest preachers to come and visit us while Louisa's away. Top two announcements there are just our regulars on this coming Friday morning. If you're around 7 o'clock in the church here, come and join me here and for a short time of prayer and a piece of toast and a cup of coffee, and everyone's welcome. Otherwise, we just encourage you wherever you are at 7 o'clock just to spend some time in prayer, praying for the church, praying for our community. And then next Friday night is our regular fortnightly Bible study. Bring your diaries from 6:30, we start at 7 o'clock and we normally wrap up by around 8 o'clock again. Everyone's welcome to come and join us. Finally, when Louisa's back towards the end of July there, we have our third hymnfest. So it's a time where we celebrate our favourite hymns in the congregation. So email Louisa, tell her what your favourite hymn is, or come and have a chat with me afterwards and we'll put it on the list of hymns that we'll sing on the day. Finally, I think you can see all the great work happening in the church at the back there. Lots of painting going on. The next job we're going to be doing, Nicole, is polishing the floors in early August, I believe. Which means I think we're penciling in, watch this space, a working bee for after that Hymnfest on 28th of July, where we need to move lots of things to make the floor space empty. I'm not sure how we're going to do that, but we're going to be moving. Yeah. So watch your space and we'll confirm exactly when that is, but many hands make light work, so it'd be great if you can join us on that working bee so we can get the floor looking great. I think that's all about any announcements for this week.
Can I ask
you? Oh, yes.
I've got a new project going. I'm wanting if anyone's doing a clean out of their fancy teacups and saucers and plates instead of donating to other people, bring them to me. I'm doing something special.
Okay, so any type of plates or is it?
Teacups and saucers, you know.
Specifically teacups and saucers.
Yeah.
Any teacups and saucers? When is it?
Nice fancy ones. I need to get rid of them.
Okay, so not IKEA ones. You want
to ask. I don't know what crown.
Right, thanks everyone.
So Peter is going to bring us our two readings for today. Thanks, Peter.
Good morning, all. First reading comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 to 22. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and all members of the household of God, built upon the foundations of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The second reading comes from Gospel. It's a gospel reading, John chapter 17, verses 1 to 11. Jesus prays for his disciples. After Jesus had spoken the words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life. This they may know you, and only true God, by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those who you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave me I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable, our God and our Redeemer. Amen. So, yesterday, by date, we celebrated the 47th anniversary of the United Church. And so I think today there will be many congregations and faith communities marking in that in worship today, reflecting on the prayer of Jesus that so inspired the UCA's formation back in 1977. It was John 17, verse 11, which Peter just read, that they may be one. Jesus, when Peter read the start of that reading, he said, Jesus prays for his disciples. That's the little, you know, tag at the top of that reading. But read, Jesus prayed for us. He was praying for us, and he continues to implore us to be one so that we will be glorified. So today, let's reflect on our identity as the United Church. And we'll ask questions such as, what is distinctive about the United Church? What do we value? What do we find challenging? And potentially, how are we changing? Something really intrinsic to our identity as the United Church is our name. The foundational people decided intentionally to call it the Uniting Church, not the United Church, because uniting is ongoing, it's unfinished, something that we are called into constantly. Seeking unity is core to our DNA as the Uniting Church. Unity in our hearts and lives with God, unity with each other and with our world. And if you've never looked into it, the process of becoming the Uniting Church was epic. It took decades of talking with various Christian denominations. This mind-blowing concept that churches could come together. Who'd have thought? And to come together to become part of this new, holy Australian church. And there were various churches that entered the conversation at times. Entered the conversation but did not or could not make the commitment to come into the United Church. Perhaps because they were unable to find a path away from traditions that were based maybe in another country. And so the concept of saying, we are Australian church, seemed perhaps to them too much of a rejection of traditions from England. So the Anglicans at one point were in this conversation, the Lutherans at one point were in the conversation, but, you know, it didn't happen. And once the Methodist and Presbyterian and Congregational churches had committed to the vision, there was still much, much work to be done. The three churches rejected the idea of what they called ecclesiastical carpentry. So trying to mash this thing together with a bit of Presbyterianism here and a bit of Methodism there and a bit of Congregational on the top. It was never going to work like that. The outcome would have been confusing and probably pretty unwieldy. You know what they call a camel? A horse designed by committee? It would just would have been a bit like that. They started to build an understanding from the ground up, working through, meticulously I'm sure, working through and agreeing upon doctrinal understandings that they could all hold. And those ones are set out in the basis of union. They worked on our code of ethics and ministry practice, our constitution and regulations, and the structure of the church at national, state, regional and local levels. It was precise work and it took a long time. And then when the church was declared on the 22nd of June 1977, they made a statement to the nation announcing the church. And if you ever get hold of this statement, and it's available on the Assembly website, it's a really impressive document. I downloaded it as I was preparing this and I was thinking, have I got time to say it all? I don't think I have, but I'm going to read some excerpts from it. It's really aspirational. And reading it now with 2024 sensibilities, it continues to be incredibly aspirational, but a very high level of overt political engagement. That's what, you know, just reading it in with my 2024 vision on. So it starts off, a new church has been born. Wow, what a aspirational state, you know, very ambitious kind of statement to start with. And they talked, I'm not gonna say it all, but they talked about addressing the Australian people with this historic document. And they said, the path to unity has been long and at times difficult, but we believe this unity is a sign of the reconciliation we seek for the whole human race. So the struggle that they'd been through, they actually felt was emblematic. And then they talked about, you know, acknowledging with gratitude the churches that had come, and they said, a Christian responsibility to society has always been regarded as fundamental to the mission of the church. In the United Church, our response to the Christian gospel will continue to involve us in social and national affairs. So they were nailing their colours to the mast at that point, saying we are engaged in the work of the world. We are part of the world and we are engaged in it. And they talked about their responsibilities beyond the country, so the fact that they're part of the Pacific and Southeast Asia, so they talked about that. And then they said, again, the parts that I'm going to read out are the parts that talk about our engagement in the work of the world, the politics, and our approach to caring for all people. We affirm our eagerness to uphold basic Christian values and principles, such as the importance of every human being, the need for integrity in public life, the proclamation of truth and justice, the rights for each citizen to participate in decision-making in the community, religious liberty and personal dignity, and a concern for the welfare of the whole human race. Big statements. And then they talked about, we pledge ourselves to work to seek the correction of injustices wherever they occur. We will work for the eradication of poverty and racism within our society and beyond. We affirm the rights of all people to equal educational opportunities, adequate health care, freedom of speech, employment, or dignity in unemployment if work is not available. We will oppose all forms of discrimination which infringe basic rights and freedoms. These are huge statements. We will challenge the values which emphasise acquisitiveness and greed in disregard for all the needs of others, and which encourage a higher standard of living for the privileged in the face of the daily widening gap between the rich and the poor. And that was written nearly 50 years ago. So let's be clear that some of those things now, the gap is way wider. We are concerned with the basic human rights of future generations, and we will urge, listen to this in light of what has been announced in the last week, we will urge the wise use of energy, the protection of the environment, and the replenishment of the Earth's resources for their use and enjoyment. Finally, we affirm that the first allegiance of Christians is to God, under whose judgment the policies and actions of all nations must pass. We realise that sometimes this allegiance may bring us into conflict with the rulers of our day. But our uniting church, as an institution within the nation, must constantly stress the universal values which must find expression in national policies if humanity is to survive. We pledge ourselves to hope and work for a nation whose goals are not guided by self-interest alone, but by concern for the welfare of all persons everywhere. And then it finishes, in the spirit of Jesus' self-giving love, we seek to go forward. Very, very aspirational. And in the light of the highly polarized political situation in which we now find ourselves, those words from nearly 50 years ago are remarkable. They engage the church with the world in which we live, and yes, with the politics with which we live. The church must have a voice in the justice struggles of our times. It cannot be sitting in a bubble, ignoring the needs, and not speaking into spaces where decisions are made. When I read that statement again, at times, you know, it just seems so altruistic and so aspirational. I almost sort of yearn for to recover that 1977 vision to live more fully into the prayer of Jesus and to see this most fully expressed in recovering somehow that ecumenical vision that we had back then. There's no doubt that this aspiration remains important. And when I pulled up this morning, I looked at your sign and it says, stand up and defend the poor and needy. I went, no, it's going to work for my sermon. Jesus' prayer for us, prayer for the disciples, sure, but a prayer for us is that we may be one. That was part of the vision of the Uniting Church right from the beginning. It remains Jesus' calling to us. And this idea of oneness is a powerful thing when the church lives a way of life that is clearly and obviously different to the world of conflict and division and inequity in which we live. How do we marry those two? We are called to be communities characterized by the way we seek to overcome division, by the way we handle disagreements, by the way we use our time and energy, our wealth and our properties for the good of the communities we're part of, by the way we live for the sake of the world God loves. So we are not here just to maintain our own worshiping communities, to be comfortable with our own practices, but we are here to be evidence of the kingdom of God. And as we know, the paradoxical upside down nature of the kingdom of God constantly flies in the face of the world's values. I said before that I have been a hospital chaplain in the public space, but that is coming to an end. And as it turns out, over the past 5 weeks, I've actually preached somewhere different every Sunday. And so, funnily enough, coming up to this anniversary, I've really had the privilege to see a whole lot of UCA communities. So I haven't been to my church for some weeks now. I've had the privilege, though, to see United Church communities of faith living into this call and this prayer of Jesus. I've shared with congregations who are attempting to create new missional opportunities, really trying to start and say, who are we? What can we do? How can we move forward with that? I'm being with those who are making clear decisions about really different ways of operating. That was how we were in the past, but we need to change and we need to do something different now. And I've also been part of churches that are breaking down the walls of the church to truly become one with their community. And that's aspirational and inspirational. And for myself, as a long-time chaplain, I've sat with many people and heard stories of people who have traveled the path of ill health. For some of them, it's about neglect and abuse and vulnerability. And I see that as being just the cutting edge of where the church needs to be, with people who are at the point of pain, at the point where they feel most friendless and disconnected. That is where we connect with people. Because when vulnerable people become, or can feel affirmed and can start to connect, it is possible for them to find courage and resilience for themselves. Chaplaincy is not being a counsellor, it's not being a psychologist or how to work your way out of this problem. What a chaplain does is it helps the person find the resources within themselves to help, to remind them of what they've done in the past and who's around them and supporting them and help them find their own way out. And then sometimes when people are able to find courage and resilience for themselves, they are then able to be agents of change and love and support for other people. So I guess for me it's a great sadness that chaplains are few and far between now. And I feel like when I look back at that statement to the nation in 1977, the uniting church at its start might have been astonished at that situation. In our church, we've heard stories of the impact of colonization and the long-term harm that it's created for generations of families of First Peoples. But equally, we've heard stories of their grace and strength in reaching out to Second Peoples in seeking reconciliation and understanding. And we have all heard stories of communities pulling together after natural disasters, neighbours reaching out to neighbours, offering whatever's needed, meals, somewhere to stay, electricity, whatever. The work of the United Church is incredibly broad, and when people in human services work understand that, they're often astonished at the breadth of where the United Church is engaged in some of this work. Not just in hospitals, not just in aged care, but in some of the lesser known work. So in things like justice and advocacy, in emergency relief for those living with homelessness, supporting people with disability. supporting vulnerable families and children, especially after domestic violence. Supporting opportunities for people to come together in communities. So these sort of ways of connecting people. Social events, community gardens, homework clubs, ukulele groups. I'm a ukulele player. And community choirs or walking groups or whatever it is. So in that John reading, Jesus was saying to his disciples, he was giving them a warning about what was to come. We are living in the time of Pentecost, asking ourselves the question of how we might live into this life that Christ offers. We think about that Pentecost story. We remember that people did not find themselves all speaking the same language. They didn't all become the same as each other. They still spoke their own very different languages. They retained their own particular culture and identity. But they discovered that when they attended, when they listened carefully, they could understand each other. I'm just going to go back and read that first verse of the Ephesians reading. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. So when Jesus prays that we may all be one, it doesn't mean we have to be the same. It means knowing our distinctive differences, but discovering we can learn to listen and understand, get along with each other, with our differences, and work together for the good of the world beyond ourselves. And that is an incredibly powerful witness to the gospel. When we become communities of reconciliation, sharing what we have, coming together for the sake of a shared love of the world that God loves. So those closing words in that John reading are a really fitting finish, I think. It says, and now I'm no longer in the world, but they, and read us, we are in the world. And I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name as you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. So that's the story. Jesus is no longer in the world. We know that. The incarnation of Jesus is over. Jesus has been resurrected and ascended to the Father, but we are still in the world. Jesus' works are now in our hands, and Jesus is counting on us to be his presence in the wake of his absence. And that blessing is one which I feel needs to be a theme of this entire season of Pentecost, that we are part of the ongoing work of God. Amen. We're going to sing him. No, we're not. We're going to do an affirmation of faith. Now, sometimes people do a creed. We very often will do the Nicene Creed. But we're going to do the creed, or it's an affirmation of faith that's based on the basis of union. And this was, again, written at the start of union. And I think we might just remain sitting, but we'll say it together, if that's okay. We are a pilgrim people. We believe in one God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We proclaim Jesus Christ, the crucified and risen one, confessing him as Lord to the glory of God the Father. In the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we acclaim Jesus as the Lord of the Church, the head over all things, the beginning of a new creation. We acknowledge that we live and work between the time of Christ's death and resurrection and the consideration of all things which he will bring. We are a pilgrim people, always on the way towards a promised goal. On the way, Christ feeds us with word and sacraments, and we have the gift of the Spirit in order that we may not lose the way. We will live and work within the faith and unity of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, bearing witness to that unity which is both Christ's gift and his will. We affirm that every member of the Church is engaged to confess the faith of Christ crucified. Together with all the people of God, we will serve the world for which Christ died, and we await with hope the day of the Lord Jesus. Now sing a hymn. Make me a channel of your peace.
Going to do our prayers a little bit. Thanks, Craig.
prayers for people. As you can see, we've got some people sick at the moment in the congregation, so we'll be praying for healing. And also we've got people travelling overseas, school holidays coming up. Before I begin, does anybody have any other prayer requests that want to raise this morning?
Pray for my young brother, who is in the
room. Your younger brother in Fiji, yes. Okay, we have a prayer for healing for Peter's brother.
Pray for my neighbour who's just lost his wife.
Sorry,
pray for my neighbour who's just lost his wife.
Okay, we will do. Pray for those in the morning. So, in the spirit of our beginnings as a United Church in Australia, let's all bow our heads in our prayers for people. Lord, as a church set within Southeast Asia and the Pacific, make us true neighbours to those among whom we live. In a country which has been richly blessed, give us courage to stand for justice, to end poverty and discrimination, and to support that which offers dignity to all people. As those born into freedom, may we uphold human rights, participate in the constant search for truth, live with integrity, and hold concern for the whole human race. But Lord, we lift up our prayers for the church and the world. We pray for the conflicts in the world, Gaza, Israel, Ukraine, and the many other war zones around the world that don't make the news. God, grant wisdom and compassion to leaders, strength to peacemakers, and relief to those who suffer. Bring about a lasting peace in all areas of conflict. In our local community, help us to be a beacon of hope and love. May Windsor United Church be the light on the hill. May you provide support to those who work tirelessly to meet the needs of our neighbours and guide us to see and respond to the needs around us. Lord, for those who need healing, for theirs, for Peter's brother, whether in mind, body, spirit, may your healing touch be upon them. Grant them comfort, strength and restoration. Surround them with love and care from their families, friends and caregivers. Lord, we pray for Nicole's neighbour who's in mourning after the loss of a loved one, Lord. Holy Spirit, comfort them at this time. And now let's just have a short time of silence as we lift up to God anything that is currently on our hearts. God, we pray that nothing in all the earth will separate us from your love in Christ Jesus. May we live as though we belong to you, and may our unity be a humble sign of hope in this place where we make our witness. In Jesus' name.
Let's join together now in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in a time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we close our service, let's sing one more hymn, 111, Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Oh,
We go in hope and love into the world.
May God, the heart of life, be deep within us. God, the Christ, be present in our history. And God, the Spirit, give us power, truth, and peace. Amen.